So now let us begin the translation method. The translation method, sometimes also known as the classical method, as I told you, is a traditional teaching technique that was used to teach Latin and Greek, and was particularly in vogue, I must say, in the 16th century. The focus at that time was on the translation of texts. Like you know, when English was introduced in India, the focus wasn't on the spoken English. The focus was on understanding, means to understand the language, or to write it, or to be able to read it. That was the focus. So even the, you know, this method is followed for teaching Latin and Greek. Even the Europeans, they learned Latin and Greek through this method. Why? As I said, the focus was on translation of texts, or say teaching of grammar and rote learning of vocabulary. Rote learning of vocabulary. Okay. What does it mean, rote learning of? Means they learned the rules by heart. If you know the rules, that doesn't mean that you can even speak the language. Well, you can understand it, you can read, or you can even write. But as far as spoken part is concerned, spoken is skill is concerned, you cannot acquire simply by learning the rules of grammar, syntax and all. So there was no emphasis on speaking and listening comprehension, because Latin and Greek were taught more as academic subjects rather than as means of oral communication. Okay, rather than as means of oral communication. Now, you know, in the present century, in the present decade, or say since the past few decades, English is being taught for the oral communication, so that we are able to communicate in English. Now our students are able to communicate in English. So we have advanced there in this area, you may say. You know, I was telling you about Latin and Greek. The same can be said about teaching of Sanskrit and Arabic, or say Persian in India. The learners of these languages know how to read, write and understand, but speaking fluently in them remains a mere dream for them. Like, you know, as far as students are concerned, they can read Arabic text, okay? They can even write something there in Arabic. And same can be said about Sanskrit. You know, we taught it there in a curriculum. Since then, since it is there in our curriculum, we learn it, we learn to read, we learn to write. But as far as speaking is concerned, Some can, you know, with their diligence, with their devotion, with their dedication, also learn how to speak a little, but they cannot speak fluently. Same can be said about Persian also. Although, you know, there were many poets like Ghalib and all who composed their couplets and ghazals in Persian, but there were very few. How many Ghalibs are there here? Very few. Okay. And you know, since Kalidas and all, they composed epics and works in Sanskrit, because Sanskrit was in vogue, say in the ancient India, you may say. As far as, you know, Sanskrit is concerned, it was spoken, it was written, it was understood very well, say around 1000 years ago. But now very few understand Sanskrit. The translation method is thus the oldest teaching method of English, I must say, in India. It is as old as the introduction of English in the country. You know, when the English came here, they introduced this method, and when they introduced it, the easiest method that we thought was the translation method, and it was in fact the easiest method. So we took it up. In spite of other methods of teaching English, this method, I must say, is still used in most of the classrooms in India. You know, if you happen to go to rural schools, even now, okay, even today, if you have a round of the schools, then you would find the teachers of English teaching through the translation method. So even now, this is followed. Okay, even now it is followed. And suppose if I talk about the principles of the translation method, then I would say the translation method is based on the on certain principles, like translation interprets the words and phrases of the foreign language in the best possible manner. Like, you know, you can have one-to-one equivalent, you may say. So it is based, it interprets the words and phrases of the foreign language in the best possible manner, in the sense that suppose if you ask me like how to explain the word method, so I would tell the meaning in Hindi instead of defining the word, because if I'm defining method, if I'm defining adopt, if I'm defining adapt, that would take time. It would be time consuming, and not only that, students might not understand the meaning exactly. They will not get the one-to-one equivalent. It would be baffling for them. So what is the first principle as far as principle of translation method is concerned? That it interprets the words and phrases of the foreign language in the best possible manner, which is not possible with the direct method or audiolingual method for that matter. The foreign physiology is best assimilated, you know, best absorbed in this process of interpretation. Like, you know, students do not forget the meanings if you tell them the Hindi equivalents to them. Like, you are once told, well, pen means kalam, okay, and this handkerchief means rumal, so they are going to remember it. And so, suppose, you know, if you ask me what is pen, and I'm defining, well, it's a cylindrical object, and there's ink in it, and it is used for writing. Now, see, what a big description I'm giving. Or say, what's handkerchief? Well, it's a square piece of cloth which is used for wiping face and all. So if you're giving, you know, these definitions, they are time consuming, and they do not understand it, they would forget it. So if I'm just telling them, well, pen means kalam and handkerchief mean rumal, then this, you know, these words will be assimilated in their memory. They won't forget it. So you may say the English physiology is, or the foreign physiology for that matter, is best assimilated, best absorbed in this process of interpretation. Like, you know there are certain words like nobody says chamach or chamcha because we are told that instead of saying chamach and chamcha, you know, we find spoon a easy word. We do not say samachapat. Instead of samachapat, we say newspaper. And we don't even say television. What do we say? Television, Hindi. Doordarshan. We don't say doordarshan. Or we do not say doorbhash. Do we? We don't. We don't say even samay. Right? In place of them, you know, what words do we use? We say television, telephone, time. Or say the answer sheet that you got. When you write your answers there in exam, we call it answer sheet, okay? And some students, I don't know, they call it copy, which is a very wrong word, in place of notebook. So we say notebook. And I don't even know, like, what is the Hindi version of this. Why? Because these English words, they have been absorbed in our in our minds. They have been very nicely assimilated. I hope you understand this.
Yes, sir.
So this is easy, you know, that way. The translation method is very easy. And even the structures of the foreign language are best learned when compared and contrasted with those of the mother tongue. If I'm just teaching my students the structures of English language, they wouldn't understand. But if I compare the structures, okay, with the Hindi version, say I'm talking about Hindi, as I said earlier, that I would be confining myself as transition is concerned to Hindi language, because this is the language that is spoken in this part of our country. So we may tell our students that in English language we have S plus V plus O, okay? This is structure, we have S plus V plus O, whereas in Hindi or say Urdu, what structure do you have? You have S plus O plus V. So you can tell your students, कि दे कैन कंपेयर एंड दे वुड नो वेल इफ वी आर राइटिंग इन इंग्लिश वी हैव टू फॉलो दिस इज स्ट्रक्चर व्हेयर इन आवर मदर टंग दिस इज फॉलोड आई ईट अ मैंगो आई सब्जेक्ट ईट वर्ब मैंगो इज ऑब्जेक्ट एंड मैं आम खाता हूं इज वर्ब आम इज ऑब्जेक्ट एंड मैं इज सब्जेक्ट सो दिस इज सो सिंपल सो लाइक we can tell this structure through students based on the students understand the difference in sentence structures of L1 and L2 okay again I would like to tell you what is L1 is your mother tongue okay L1 is your mother tongue I'll be using these words that's why I want you to remember them do not forget them L2 is this is language 1 okay language 1 which is the language you have learned first
Mother tongue.
And which is your mother tongue?
Hindi.
Hindi is your mother tongue. Well, so this is language one. And which language are you learning as the second language?
English.
English you are learning as the second language. Very good. So this is L2. And since you are learning this language, this is also called as the target language. Okay. What is it called? The target language. And it is also called as the second language. Why? Because this is your second language, and that is why you would find you know this acronym, this abbreviation ESL English as a second language. What does it mean? English is a second language. So English is a second language for us. It's not our mother tongue. So in all those countries where English does not happen to be mother tongue, English is taught as a second language. ESL. Remember this. So what do we see, you know, once you tell your students the structures of the mother tongue and that of the foreign language, that is the target language, then very soon they understand the difference in sentence structure. And they start forming correct sentences in the second language. Forming correct sentences in the English language. Okay? Or say in the target language. If you know there are dissimilarities, now here there is a dissimilarity in the structure, there are similarities too. And these common features prove very advantageous in picking up the nuances of the second language. You know, all languages have their own nuances, they all have their peculiarities. And if you understand the peculiarities of the language, the nuances of the language, you understand it. It's very important. And it takes time. You can understand the nuances, you can understand the peculiarities only when you immerse yourself there in language teaching or language learning process. Now, I was telling about the similarities. Now, if there are dissimilarities in the structures, there are similarities also. So try to exploit the similarities as teachers of English. You are all going to be teachers of English, so you must try to exploit the similarities that we have in the two languages, the English language and your own mother tongue, the Hindi language. For example, the closeness between English and Hindi idioms. Well, I'll be selecting here those idioms where you have, you know, almost similar translation there in the mother tongue. For example, necessity is the mother of invention. If you're telling this idiom to your student, he might forget it. But if you give him the Hindi version, then he might not. He would retain it there in his memory. Like what do we say? Avishyakta avishkar ki janni hai. Avishyakta avishkar ki janni hai. This is what we say.
Yes.
Yeah, like avishyakta is zarurat. Zarurat jo hai wo ijad ki maa hai. Zarurat ijad ki maa hai. This is how we would say in Urdu. Like, you know, prevention is better than cure. Prevention is better than cure. How would you translate? Prevention is better than cure. Ilaaj se parhez acha hai. Ilaaj se parhez acha hai. Parhez is prevention. Ilaaj is treatment, cure. So prevention is better than cure. So if you have, you know, like the similar equivalent, then it is important that you tell it or you share it with your students so that they do not remember. They do not forget. Okay, so that they remember lifelong. Like, practice makes a man perfect. Practice makes a man perfect. A very, you know, common proverb. A common proverb. And you also have a Hindi version. And this is said by a Hindi poet. Do you remember? Yes? Well, I am giving you a hint. It has got the word Karat. Karat. No? You can't make out? Well, it's escaping me as well. Karat karat abhyas ke jadmati ho sujan. Karat karat abhyas ke jadmati ho sujan. Now I remember the entire couplet. Rasri avat jate silpa parat nisan. Now you remember? Okay. Do not forget the whatever you teach, try to retain that. Because, you know, like, you know, if you learn Hindi language, if you learn Sanskrit language, Urdu language, they all support in learning other languages. Say, tit for tat. Now, this is a very common idiom. Tit for tat. What do you say in Hindi?
Jaise kuch aisa.
Very good. Jaise kuch aisa. Yeah. So, here you could pass on. Jaise kuch aisa. Yes, you're right. Or say, where there is a flower, there is a thorn. Where there is a flower, there is a thorn. Jahan phool, wahan kaata. You can give this translation, jahan phool, wahan kaata. Now your student is going to remember, where there is a flower, there is a thorn. A similar is, you know, where there is a will, there is a way. Where there is a will, there is a way. So, it seems as though this has been influenced by that idiom. Because that one is a very common one. This is not that common. Where there is a flower, there is a thorn. Jahan phool, wahan kaata. Now, you know, I'm reminded of phool and kaata we are talking about. I am reminded of a couplet. Hamne kaaton ko bhi narmi se chhua hai aksar. Hamne kaaton ko bhi narmi se chhua hai aksar. Log bedard hain, phoolon ko masal dete hain. Log bedard hain, phoolon ko masal dete hain. So, enjoy the couplet. Okay. And you know, like, I am reminded of a dialogue also which became very popular. It's from Dilip Kumar's movie Mughal-e-Azam. Kaaton ko mujhane ka khauf nahi hota, zil-e-ilahi, ya sahib-e-alam. Kaaton ko mujhane ka khauf nahi hota, sahib-e-alam. This was on phool and kaate. Okay. Now, can you give me any other proverb or idiom where you have a similar translation in Hindi, in your mother tongue? Okay. Better alone than in a bad company. Better alone than in a bad company. Buri sangat se akela bhala. Buri sangat se akela bhala. Okay. I might not be like giving you the exact, but you know, this is very close to. And this is how, you know, I have learnt while I studied Hindi, in fact, there in my 9th and 10th standard. So, better alone than in a bad company. These English idioms and proverbs, maxim, we still use, and we use even Hindi ones. So, I might, you know, not be very true with words, but, you know, I'm giving you the soul. Buri sangat se akela bhala. It's better to be alone than in a bad company. Man is known by the company he keeps. Manushya, or aadmi, or insaan, apni sangati se pehchana jata hai. Manushya, apni sangati se, insaan apni sangati se pehchana jata hai. Sangat is very important. Your parents must have told you this, that you have to have a good company. If you have a good company, then you become a good person, and if you don't have a good company, then you do not become a good company. So company is very important. Sangat is very important. Okay? Yes. Now, yes. Can you give me another? Some similar? Yes. Think of, you know, there are number of many are coming in my mind. Lost time is never found again. Lost time is this, you know, my grandfather would often say this thing, like, you know, when I would be like wasting away my time in playing in a hole, then he would say, lost time is never found again. What does it mean? बीता हुआ समय कभी हाथ नहीं आता. Okay? बीता हुआ समय कभी हाथ नहीं आता. And this reminds me of a song again, an old song, गुजरा हुआ जमाना आता नहीं दोबारा, हाफिज खुदा तुम्हारा, हाफिज खुदा तुम्हारा. I hope you must have heard. तो गुजरा हुआ जमाना आता नहीं दोबारा. What does the proverb teach us? It teaches us to make the best use of time. Okay? Or how about misfortunes never come alone? You know, since we are doing the translation method, that's why, you know, I am you know, talking about these idioms and proverbs and maxims, and I am asking you to translate. Okay? So, yes, misfortunes never come alone.
मुसीबत कभी अकेले नहीं आती.
वेरी नाइस. मुसीबत कभी अकेले नहीं आती. वेरी नाइस. आई वाज नॉट एबल टू थिंक द एग्जैक्ट वन. मुसीबत कभी अकेले नहीं आती. मिसफॉर्च्यून्स नेवर कम अलोन. एंड यस, एंड ट्रुथ इज ऑलवेज बिटर. ट्रुथ इज ऑलवेज बिटर. यस,
सच कड़वा होता है.
सच कड़वा होता है. वेरी नाइस, वेरी नाइस. और सच्ची बात चुभती है. सच्ची बात चुभती है. सच कड़वा होता है. ट्रुथ इज हमेशा कड़वा होता है. हमेशा, हमेशा इज ऑल्सो देयर. ऑलवेज ट्रूथ इज ऑलवेज बिटर. ओके, सच्ची बात चुभती है. एंड ब्यूटी नीड्स नो ऑर्नामेंट्स. ओके, अ वेरी कॉमन वन, कॉमन इडियम. इट वॉज देयर इन द टेक्स्ट दैट यू आर रीडिंग यस्टरडे. ब्यूटी नीड्स नो ऑर्नामेंट्स. ब्यूटी नीड्स नो ऑर्नामेंट्स. ब्यूटी, ब्यूटी सुंदरता को ऑर्नामेंट्स, आभूषण की आवश्यकता नहीं होती. सुंदरता को आभूषण की आवश्यकता नहीं होती. या माय, यू नो, माय वन ऑफ माय टीचर्स डॉक्टर अमीन अशरफ वुड रिसाइट वेरी नाइस कपलेट्स व्हाइल टीचिंग. एंड आई डोंट नो, इट सीम्स एज दो हिज सोल हैज कम इनटू माइन. एंड दैट्स व्हाई, यू नो, आई एम रिमाइंडेड ऑफ अनदर कपलेट. अच्छी सूरत को संवरने की जरूरत क्या है. अच्छी सूरत को संवरने की जरूरत क्या है. सादगी में भी कयामत की अदा होती है. सादगी में भी कयामत की अदा होती है. यू नो, वंस ही वाज टीचिंग अस लॉर्ड बायरन्स पोयम, शी वॉक्स इन ब्यूटी. शी वॉक्स इन ब्यूटी. यस, यू टू मस्ट हैव रेड दैट पोयम, शी वॉक्स इन ब्यूटी. एंड द कपलेट दैट इज रिसाइटेड आई स्टिल रिमेंबर. एंड सपोज माय फ्रेंड्स और क्लासमेट्स हैपन टू वॉच दिस वीडियो, दे माइट आइडेंटिफाई दिस एक्सपीरियंस. Yes, जो उठाई उसने रुख से नकाब, जो उठाई उसने रुख से नकाब, सुबह की पहली किरण शर्मा गई. सुबह की पहली किरण शर्मा गई. एंड अदर कपलेट ही सेड रिसाइटेड व्हाइल टीचिंग दिस पोयम. यस, नाजुकी उसके लब की क्या कहिए. दिस इज बाय मीर तकी मीर. ओके, अ वेरी रेनाउंड पोएट. नाजुकी उसके लब की क्या कहिए, पंखुड़ी एक गुलाब की सी है. नाजुकी उसके लब की क्या कहिए, पंखुड़ी एक गुलाब की सी है. ओके, नाउ यू नो वी हैड वेयर देयर इज अ फ्लावर, देयर इज अ थॉर्न. नाउ या देयर इज अ वेरी पॉपुलर, वेरी कॉमन फ्रेज व्हिच यू कैन से, वेयर देयर इज अ फ्लावर देयर इज अ, देयर इज अ थॉर्न. सिमिलर वन, कैन यू थिंक ऑफ. यस प्लीज.
Where there is a will, there is a way.
जहाँ चाह वहाँ रहा. जहाँ चाह वहाँ रहा. तो you have the, if you tell your student, well, it means this, जहाँ चाह वहाँ रहा, तो he is going to remember. Yeah, जहाँ चाह वहाँ रहा. You know Allama Iqbal, you know his सारे जहाँ से अच्छा. He has written very nice poems, you know, very nice ghazals. And they, which are very inspiring, which are very motivational. And here, you know, when you're saying where there is will, there is a way. So I'm reminded of his couplet. This is very popular one. You must have heard it. Khudi ko kal buland itna ki hai taqdeer se pehle. Khudi ko kal buland itna ki hai taqdeer se pehle. Khuda bande se khud puche, bata teri raza kya hai. Khuda bande se khud puche, bata teri raza kya. It means. Make your will so strong, okay, so strong that even God might ask you for your consent before making any decisions about your life. Okay, now, as you sow, so shall you reap. This is very common one. This you must, yes, tell me the Hindi version of it. as you sow, this is SOW, sow, as you sow, so shall you reap. You had a theme writing also last year on this topic, on this line, as you sow, so shall you reap.
जैसा बोओगे वैसा काटोगे.
जैसा बोओगे वैसा काटोगे. वेरी गुड. जैसा बोओगे वैसा काटोगे. यस. एंड हाउ अबाउट अ फ्रेंड इन नीड इज अ फ्रेंड इन डीड. अ वेरी कॉमन वन विच वी यूज ऑलमोस्ट एवरी डे. अ फ्रेंड इन नीड इज अ फ्रेंड इन डीड. यू नो इन इंग्लिश, बट डू यू नो ऑल्सो इन हिंदी? विथ वही जो मुसीबत में काम आए, विद वही जो परेशानी में काम है. दोस्त कौन है? दोस्त वही अच्छा है जो कि हमारी परेशानी में, हमारी तकलीफ में साथ दे. तो अ फ्रेंड इन नीड इज अ फ्रेंड इन डीड. हाउवर यू डोंट हैव फ्रेंड्स लाइक दैट. वी डू नॉट फाइंड सच नाइस फ्रेंड्स, यू नो, दे आर वेरी स्कैस. देयर इज अ सीरियस डर्थ ऑफ गुड फ्रेंड्स इन फैक्ट. एंड आई होप यू हैव नाइस फ्रेंड्स एंड यू बिकम नाइस फ्रेंड्स एंड कंटिन्यू टू बी नाइस. यू नो, इट्स अ ब्लेसिंग ऑफ गॉड इफ यू हैव अ नाइस फ्रेंड. अदरवाइज यू नो आई वुड से फ्रेंड्स, यू नो, दे ऑलमोस्ट लाइक मौसम. इन फैक्ट, ओके, मिल भी जाते हैं तो कतरा के निकल जाते हैं. हाय, मौसम की तरह दोस्त बदल जाते हैं. तो दिस इज हाउ फ्रेंड्स आर, यू नो, दे आर जस्ट, यू नो, दे मिस, दे चेंज एज डू द सीजंस चेंज. So it is observed that when we know the mother tongue correspondent of the English phrase, proverb or idiom, then we learn and retain the foreign language versions quite easily. Okay? You know, the purpose here behind giving the examples of idioms, proverbs and maxims is that the English language can be very well or can be easily learned and taught even through translation. Like, you know, I was doing translation and, you know, it was a joyful experience, was it not? If you are making it a joyful experience, a lively experience, an interesting experience, then students are going to enjoy it. So even if you are teaching through translation method, do not teach it in a dull manner. Teach it in an interesting manner. Okay, make it interesting, make it joyful, make it a fun, involve your students. I'm telling you all this again because you are all going to be would-be teachers, you know, you are all would-be teachers. So this is how, even if you happen to teach translation method, make it interesting by your imagination. Okay, share your experiences with them. Share you the way I'm sharing, you know, I was reminded of my teacher because, you know, some teachers, they influence us lifelong. We do not forget them. And the best teachers are those teachers which we remember lifelong, which we do not forget. And they are the ones, you know, like who taught us beyond the text. They were not like spoon feeding us. Once you are there in college, once you are there in the university, you don't need spoon feeding. And try to understand it. And do not expect us to spoon feed you, please. Okay? Let us teach you beyond text. Our intention, our purpose is to widen your horizon, to share our experiences with you, to make you a better teacher. Because, you know, I remember, I'm telling you from my own experience, I remember my those teachers who were teaching beyond the text. If suppose a teacher, you know, happens to teach you just a solitary reaper, line by line, is just paraphrasing you, then, you know, you do not remember him. You do not find it a joyful experience. So make it a joyful experience by using your imagination, by sharing your experiences. So, you know, the experiences of our teachers, they pass on from